Basically, we'll go through the introduction today, and then maybe, if time allows, we will look at Zoroastrianism very briefly and Judaism. First of all, you know, why are we studying the issue of comparative religions? You know, we are Muslims, we are Shia Muslims, we follow Islam. But we had to realize Islam started in the 7th century of the Common Era. And so we were not there from the very beginning. There were many other religions before us. There were many, many religions which came after us. So we have to basically, you know, it's important for us to know where do we fit in? What is the relationship between us and other religions? And so that we can know and explain our own beliefs, look at the common things between the different religions, and also the issue of, you know, finding the differences which exist. The questions that I asked about the on the quiz, basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send only Prophet Muhammad. There were 124,000 prophets. 313 of them were also Rasul. And this was not in the quiz, but look at the number. You know only four books which were revealed. There's not only four. The four ones are the famous ones. There were 104 books which were revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to various prophets. The name of Torah and Injil and Zabur and Quran are the famous ones. Out of all these 124,000 prophets, four of them were Arabs. Now we know our Rasul was an Arab, so he's one of the four. What about other three? Any guess there? Yes?
I'm not sure.
No. He's before the Arabs. You can't classify him as an Arab. In a sense, he didn't speak Arabic. Although he comes from Iraq. Any other name? Yes?
Prophet Suleiman?
Suleiman, no. Pure Jewish.
I think Prophet Musa and Hari.
No, they are also all Jewish. We have Prophet Hud, Prophet Saleh, Prophet Shu'aib, and Prophet Muhammad. Peace be upon all of them. They were all four Arab prophets. Now, as far as the names are concerned, out of 124,000 prophets, we only know the names of 56. 27 of them have been mentioned in the Quran. 9 of them have been, their story has come in the Quran, but the name doesn't appear in the Quran. And 10 others are those who have been mentioned in Hadith. So you get up a number of 56 prophets out of 124. Those who are known to us. And so, you know, we are going to have different nations and religions around the world. And that is why it is important for us to sometimes sit down and compare our faith with the faith and religions of other communities, to see the common features as well as the differences, so that we know our own position on various issues. The religions that we will try to discuss, cover, and we might not be able to cover all of them. Basically, this is the list in alphabetical order. We have Baha'ism, Buddhism, Christianity, Confucianism, Hinduism, Islam, Judaism, Sikhism, Qadianism, and Zoroastrianism. But the way we are going to discuss about them are not by the alphabetical order, neither in chronological order. We are not going through who was the first, and we discussed that. Rather, I have come up with a different division of religions, different categories. And that is important for our discussion. And that's what you will see here in the next chart. If you look at the first division, we have pre-Islamic, and then we have post-Islamic. The religions who came before Islam, and the religions who came after Islam. If you look at the pre-Islamic religions, we divided them again into two, Kitabi and non-Kitabi. Do you know the meaning of Kitabi here? What does it mean? The religions which were based on books which were revealed. And the followers of that are basically known as Ahlul Kitab. So we have two categories, Kitabi, non-Kitabi, and then we have three religions here which are post-Islamic. They came to exist after Islam started. And our judgment would be very different depending on the category. So we'll first talk about this Kitabi religion, Zoroastrianism, Judaism, Christianity. Then we'll go to briefly Hinduism, Buddhism, and then if time allows, we will also talk about the religions which have come later on. For today, before even we go to the religion that we are going to discuss, Buddhism first, Zoroastrianism first, before even we go to that, some basic rulings from the Islamic perspective is very important for us to know. How should we as Muslims, think of leaders, the founders of these religions? What is our duty towards them? And we would like to mention that right from the very beginning, before even we go into the details of the religions that we are going to discuss. And so the next point here would be founders of the faiths and our duty towards them. Number one, the prophets who have been mentioned in the Quran and Hadith, their name has come. Quran has talked about it. The prophet has mentioned it. The imam has been mentioned, for example, mentioned their names. Then we know that they are prophets and messengers of God. Our duty basically is to believe, number one, in their truth. And number two, to respect them. And this is very essential. For example, if somebody comes to me and says, I believe in one God, I believe in the Quran, I believe in Prophet Muhammad, but I deny that Jesus was a prophet of God, can we consider that person to be a Muslim? Why not? We have to believe in all the prophets, especially those who have been mentioned in the Quran and the Hadith. And Jesus has been mentioned in the Quran as a messenger of God and a prophet of God. So even if somebody says, I believe in one God, I believe in Muhammad and the Quran, but I deny Jesus or Moses or Ibrahim alayhi salam to be the prophet, then they are not actually Muslim. So on the issue of those prophets who have been mentioned in the Quran and Hadith, our duty is very clear. We have to believe in them, and we have to respect them. Then we go to those who came before Islam, about whom we don't have any evidence in the Quran or Hadith. It doesn't say either way that they are prophets, neither does it say they are not prophets. And they came before the Prophet of Islam. There we have to be careful. And that is why you see just seal your mouth there. You cannot make any judgment about them. You should not dishonor them, because there is a possibility that they might be among the true prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we believe Allah sent 124,000 prophets. And how many names we know? 56. Okay, so out of 124,000, we only know 56 names. So maybe there are many, many other prophets whom we do not know. So we should not dishonor them. And I'll just give you an example of, let's say, Krishna. You know who is Krishna? Huh? God of the Hindus. But the question is, did he himself claim to be God? Or did he end up being worshipped by his own people the way Isa has ended up being worshipped by Christians? When we see the statue of Jesus, people worshipping him, do we condemn Jesus? Or do we condemn the people? So when you talk about Krishna, if you look at his life, you know, we have no name of him in Quran or Hadith, either way, positively or negatively. But by looking at his life, you know, and his teachings, it seems that there is a possibility that he was a prophet of God, talking about one God, but people later on ended up, you know, worshipping him instead of God, just as it happened to Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam. So since we don't know, we have to be careful. We should not dishonor them, speak, you know, bad things about them. We can condemn their followers, that he is not God, you can say that much. But you cannot say, oh, he was a problem himself. Otherwise, you might be condemning a prophet about whom we do not know. Then we come to those who came after Islam, and they founded new religions. When it comes to their situation, we know very clearly, because, you know, we believe that Prophet Muhammad is the last prophet. There is no prophet or Nabi or a Rasul to come after Prophet Muhammad. So anyone who comes after him, who claims to be a prophet, our responsibility is to reject them, to deny them, and we should have nothing to do with them. Okay, so the positions are very clear. Those who have been mentioned in the Quran and Hadith, we have to believe in them and respect them. Those before Islam, but where there is no mention of them in the Quran and Hadith, we have to be careful about them. We should not criticize themselves. We can always condemn their people for worshipping them. And those who come afterwards, and we will see the examples later on. For example, Baha'u'llah, the founder of the Baha'i faith, you know, claims to be a prophet. Now, there's no prophet after Rasulullah. So if somebody says, I'm a Rasul after Rasulullah, we have to deny that person from that belief. And we said, no, you are not a Rasul. So it's in this light that we are going to look at different religions and see, you know, how things work out. So we'll start today with Zoroastrianism number one. The founder is known as Zartusht in Farsi. Probably in the earlier Parsi name was Zarathustra. Can you pronounce that? Huh? Zarathustra. Okay. Basically, this was a religion. It was the majority faith in Persia, which is now known as Iran, before Islam. Means all the Parsi people, the Farsi, you know, people of Fars, where all of them were basically Zoroastrians. The original message of Zartusht was basically to believe in one God, and the name that they had for one God is Ahura Mazda. This is how you know the Mazda car. You know, that's where you get the name. Ahura Mazda is the name of the Zoroastrian God. Just the way we prefer the name Allah in Arabic, they prefer in their own, pre-Islamic Persian language, Ahura Mazda. And he also talked about believing in the life in hereafter and to live a righteous life. Basically, there is a saying which is even common now among the Iranians in Farsi, even now. His teachings as far as his akhlaq, you know, the righteous life, is summarized in the phrase where he says, good thoughts, good deeds, good words and good deeds. So to have good thoughts, good words and good deeds. This is how you'll gain a salvation in the hereafter. What happened later on? And this is where we see that although the founder himself was a Nabi, according to many of our mujtahideen, and he talked about believing in one God, but there was corruption which came in later on. And they started believing in duality instead of believing in unity of God. And they started believing that there were two gods. One was Ahura Mazda, the creator of good, while another was Angra Manu. We don't have any car by that name, do we? No. It's the creator of evil. Because they say, you know, we see good and evil in the world, and we cannot attribute evil to the same God. We cannot say our God is creator of evil. So they ended up believing in belief of, you know, two gods. And this goes against the concept of Tawheed. So we have a serious problem when it comes to their present belief in the God of light and the God of darkness. They have a holy book which is known as Avista, which is not probably the original. And these are parts, bits and pieces from it which have survived till this time. Now, the majority of Zoroastrians, you know, they were in Iran, but after Arabs conquered Iran or Fars, gradually they became Muslims. And many of them actually migrated from there. They went to India, in the area of Gujarat and what is now known as Bombay area. And you will see many of the Zoroastrians now, probably the largest community of the Zoroastrians now is in India, especially in Bombay. And there they are known as Parsi. So if you hear anyone, you know, being called as a Parsi, they are actually Zoroastrians. Now, according to, you know, the issue is, what is their status in Shia laws? How do we look at them? Even though they actually have now moved away from Tawheed, they believe in two gods. They believe in, you know, duality instead of unity. We still, you know, they are considered by our mujtahideen to be Ahlul Kitab, because the original founder was a prophet who came to teach them to believe in one God only. And since they are Ahlul Kitab, they also would be considered to be Pak. So if a Zoroastrian cooks food for you, can you eat that? Huh? Yeah, they're just like Christians or Jews on this issue. Now, how would you explain, before even we go to the second group, if somebody says to you that I'm a Zoroastrian and we don't want to attribute evil to God, so therefore we say we have a God who created good and we have a God who created evil, how do you respond to that? Think about it for 2 minutes, although 2 minutes is not enough for that, but how would you respond to it? What they are saying is that how can you have a God who created evil? And therefore we do not believe in one God, we believe in two gods. The God of evil, the God of goodness as well as evil. You want to try?
To say if we have one God, we just say for him to test us, he needs to give us evil so we can draw attention.
So you will say it's the same God who created evil? And he did that in order to test us.
Yeah.
Okay, that's one way of responding to it. You want to respond?
God gave like jinns and humans the will to do what he wants, the kingdom is good, bad. So if there's evil in the world, it's not created by God, it's the humans. Like poverty, Allah gave us not food, but it's the unbalanced thing that he said.
So is the difference between two answers? I just want to make sure you know our thoughts and the ideas are clear. Here the response was that God, yes, the same one God who created evil also, in order to test us. So he created shaitan, let's say, so that he may test us whether we obey Allah or we obey the shaitan. Where the second response is that God only creates good. He doesn't create evil. Evil is the result of the doing of the human beings. Okay, that's one way of looking at it. And so, according to the philosophical way of responding to this question, would be the issue that God is the creator. There is nobody else but Him. But God has not created anything which is essentially evil. Even Shaitan, was he evil? Was he created as evil? No. He worshipped God for thousands of years. But then, you know, jealousy and arrogance overcame him, and he, you know, rebelled against Allah's order to do sajda to Adam. So Allah did not create Shaitan as an evil. He created him with the potential of goodness. The choice of becoming evil was Shaitan's own choice. So we would actually counter that by saying that God is not creator of evil. Evil is actually result of human actions, or even you can say, you know, it is creation of an accident. For example, if you look at a poisonous snake, will you look at a poisonous snake and say Allah created this evil? If that snake was its own habitat, nothing to do, where human beings don't go and disturb it, there's no, you know, there's supposed to be no interaction between humans and dangerous snakes. You know, so on its own, that animal is a beautiful animal. You know, people will look at the color of the hide of the snake. You know, many ladies have the purses made from the skin of the snake because it looks beautiful. But when you put a human being and the poisonous snake in the same place where they are not supposed to be, that's where you have the result of something known as evil. So Allah didn't create that as an evil. It's, you know, coming together of two things which were not supposed to be there. And that's where you have this problem of evil. So the problem of Zoroastrian people was the issue of not being able to understand this phenomenon of evil. Out of their sincerity, they didn't want to attribute that to God, and so they ended up believing in two gods, the God of goodness and the God of evil. Okay. You know, the Zoroastrian, one more comment about this community. They are very few in the world. They don't believe in conversion, so they don't go around doing dawah and tabligh to invite people to become Zoroastrian. And because of their intermarriage within the family and the larger community, their numbers are going down. It's a serious crisis that they are going through at the moment. Okay, let us now, we have about 15 minutes, but we'll try to see how much we can cover this. Okay, Judaism, as far as the founder is concerned, all of us know. It's Prophet Musa alayhi salam, and he's one of the Ulul Azm prophets. He was from Bani Israel, from the descendants of Ishaq, son of Ibrahim, peace be upon all of them. The original message of Musa alayhi salam was to worship one God and basically to follow his commandments. And the Jewish people till now have maintained that tawhid. If you go to their synagogues, you'll never see any statue or picture or image of God in any shape or form. They have a holy book, which is known as the Torah in Arabic. It's known as Torah in their own language, which was revealed upon Prophet Musa alayhi salam. However, according to our belief, you see, this is a problem when many Muslims have. They said, we believe in Torah, and there is this Old Testament, the Torah, and this thing is the same thing. No, we are talking about two different things. Torah was revealed on Musa alayhi salam. Whereas the Torah at the moment, the Old Testament, if you look at it, you will see it also talks about the death of Moses, how he died, how he was buried. So you cannot say this was a book revealed on him if it's talking about his death also. And so it is not really the original Torah, because in Jewish history, the Jewish people, first of all, when they were delivered from Pharaoh, we'll come to the history later on, there were two times they were uprooted from their land in Palestine. And in the first, after the first incident, they actually lost the original Torah. Then there was one of their prophets by the name of Ezra who rewrote Torah. And in rewriting that Torah, it was not, they were not able to maintain the original one. Now, whether he was a prophet or one of the holy men, but what we have now is actually not exactly the Torah. Some of the verses in the Old Testament would be from the original Torah. For us, the criteria is Quran. For example, in Quran, there is an ayat where Allah says, we reveal to Bani Israel an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, a life for a life. You know this whole ayat? When you look at that, you will see there is an ayat very similar to that in the present Torah also. So we would know at least that ayat there in the Old Testament is from the original Torah revealed to Musa, because the Quran confirms that. And so for us, Quran is the criteria. Whatever is there in the Quran corresponding with the Old Testament, we will consider it to be original part of the Torah. Otherwise, if it conflicts with the Quranic statement, then it would not be the authentic one. Now, what is their status in the Shia fiqh? We know that it started with Musa alayhi salam, who was a true prophet of God. Now, the problem was that the Jewish people were expected, they were told, that a Messiah will come and they have to believe in him. So when he comes, you follow him. The Messiah came in form of Jesus, but they did not follow him. Not only that, they were also told that the last prophet will come. And the predictions were so clear that according to our book, Quran, it says that the Jewish people knew the description of Prophet Muhammad as they knew their own sons. Means he had been described in the Torah in such a clear, in detailed manner. And that is why you will see that when Prophet migrated to Medina, what was the Jewish community doing there, so far away from their own land? What were they doing in Arabia? They actually knew that the city of Yathrib, which was later on known as Medina, would be the city where the last prophet will establish his first government or state. And so in prediction of that, they had gone there, they lived there, hoping that they will be there to help the last prophet. But what happened was, when the Prophet of Islam came, they were hoping that the last prophet would be from their own tribe. But when they realized he was an Arab, they didn't like him. And that's where they ended up refusing to believe in him also. So they rejected Jesus, and they also rejected the last prophet, Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But even then, in spite of that problem, our mujtahideen say, well, Quran says they are Ahlul Kitab. And so we don't have a choice but to consider them to be Ahlul Kitab, and they are also considered to be Pak. But then let me go on to the Jewish history. And I think we have to, always in our discussion with our, in school or wherever you have this discussion about the Jewish and Islam and the issue of Palestine, keep in your mind that the issue of religion is different from the issue of Zionism. You know, we believe that the Jewish people are Ahlul Kitab. We consider them to be Pak, but you know, when it comes to the present problem, this is where you have to know the history, and I tried to just summarize it here. Number one, you know, how did Judaism start? It started with Musa alayhi salam, when he basically delivered them from the Bani Israel from Egypt through the great miracle of the parting of the sea. They went to the land of Canaan, which is what is now known as Jerusalem, and they built their own kingdom and a great temple there. That is where you see the example of Suleiman and Dawood being the kings in those areas. Then, in the year 586 before Christ, this is a long, long time ago, the Babylonians. Now, when I use the word Babylonians here, it means the present Iraq. And that's why, you know, whenever Saddam, you know, whether he was sincere or not, we really doubt his sincerity. But whenever he used to say, I will, you know, send my Scud missiles to Israel, the Israeli were very, you know, concerned about it, because they always remember this example of Babylonians, that these people from that region, from Iraq, have destroyed us before. So in the year 586, before the birth of Christ, or the before Christ, the Babylonian king at that time, by the name of Bakht Nasr, he attacked Jerusalem and basically destroyed their temple completely. And he took them as his own slaves back to Babylon, to Iraq. And they spent actually centuries over there. Eventually they were allowed to go back. They were able to regain the city of Jerusalem. They rebuilt the temple. And after rebuilding the temple again, 70 years before Christ, the Romans attacked Jerusalem. Now, this is the second time that the Jerusalem is being conquered, and they also destroyed the temple. And what you see at the present time is the remnant of the destruction done by the Romans. The Romans actually, you know, then they ruled Jerusalem. Later on, Jesus came. The Romans did not believe in him. And this is Jewish people who actually presented Jesus to the Roman governor, that he's a rebel, he's a problem in our community, you have to deal with him. That is how he ended up being, according to their version, crucified. Actually, within a century after Jesus, the Romans were converted to Christianity. And so now the rulers of that area, Egypt, Palestine, Syria, or Eastern Roman Empire, they were all now Christians. So Jerusalem was basically under the control of the Christian rulers until the Muslims came on the scene. And during the days of the second Khalifa, Umar ibn Khattab, you know, the Muslims conquered Jerusalem. So the Muslims have taken Jerusalem not from the Jewish people, but from the Christian people. And it had been in the hands of the Muslims for a long, long time, for centuries, until the Crusaders took place, where for about 70 to 80 years, the Crusaders ruled Jerusalem. Then this fellow by the name of Salahuddin Ayyubi started his attack against them, and the Muslims were able to regain Jerusalem almost a century after it had fallen into the hands of the Christians. And it was in the hands of the Muslims until the Second War, where with the support of United States, with the British actually, and United States of America, the Zionist groups the Zionists among the Jewish people, because now the Jewish people were spread all around the world, especially Middle East and Europe, and they were looking for a homeland. They basically made a deal with the British and the Americans, and the British cheated the Arabs. The Arabs were cheated, and to some extent it was their own fault. They were not being clever. They were not united. And this is where, after the Second War, the State of Israel came to exist. Now, among the Jewish people themselves, there are actually two, three different groups. There is ultra-Orthodox, and then you have the conservative, and then you have the Reform Judaism. And they believe in the same thing, but it's their practice which is different. Ultra-Orthodox are very strict in following the laws of Torah. Conservative are somewhere in between. And the Reform Judaism say, you know, you have to go with the time. That you do not have to necessarily, you know, follow the the laws of the Torah. If you are modern, you follow the modern norm. So they change many things. And among them, there is a group called Haredim Jewish group, who are the ultra-Orthodox. They actually disagree with the concept of Zionism. Zionism says they believe that we need a modern state for our survival, because we are minorities all around the world, we are being persecuted, and this is where we have to be. Whereas the ultra-Orthodox Jews believe that we cannot have a state unless the Messiah comes back. So they don't believe in this concept of having a Jewish state before the Messiah's coming back. And so that's the perspective. So whenever we deal with the issue of Judaism, remember we have to separate Judaism as a religion from the issue of Zionism as a present movement and the problem that we have with them in the Palestinian scene at the moment.